Well, let's get the read on all of this. Benson Group CIO David Benson. We've got senior reporter at Barron's Mary Childs. Mary, what's interesting about this development, she didn't say anything too startling or what we would not have anticipated. She's been a longtime critic of the easing up on the restrictions that were put in place after the meltdown. It's just now they heard her say it outright, right?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think that in the aftermath of the financial crisis, there was so much talk about putting more restrictions in place, especially on these bigger institutions. And you note that kind of difference with the regional banks. There may still be that difference. Maxine Waters was saying earlier today, she did seem to emphasize kind of those too big to fail institutions that really kind of got us in trouble last time. So there may be a distinction in the rules that she's talking about, keeping a closer eye on those very big, systemically important banks and letting the regional ones kind of, you know, be a little bit more unfettered and able to conduct business.
Well, they're all getting caught in the downdraft, David. Is that justified?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think they're all getting caught up in it equally. The fact of the matter is that you still get JP Morgan here above $109 a share. It's not being caught in the same way some of the regionals could be. But even the ones that are being caught in it, Neil, it's really important to understand how toothless what Maxine Waters has said is. The fact of the matter is, you've pointed out, the regulator of these financial institutions is the Federal Reserve. The House Financial Services Committee has one thing they're allowed to do, grandstand. That's what Maxine Waters will do. And the Department of Justice is the only group that could go in and actually impugn fines on these financial institutions. So they've already impugned hundreds of billions of dollars. Nobody believes there's more of that coming. What's the real risk to the financials besides far left speech making from Maxine Waters? I just don't see it as substantive.
You know, Mary, there is another view, too, that if banks have anything to worry about, it could be this rising rate environment, which on paper should help them. But if it gets too out of hand, could hurt them. So those are dynamics in play, too, right?
Absolutely true. Yeah, there's been a lot of increasing in as the yield curve shifts and as the yield on the 10-year and others rise. That does mean possibly better business for the banks as they actually make money on that difference. But if they're facing a more strict regulatory environment, that could be a lot of tension. And I do think, I mean, as consumer protections have been rolled back as well, there is kind of a shifting landscape with who has power and who is kind of, who has jurisdiction over what part of the financial system here. So while in the past, maybe there hasn't been as much under this committee, it could be that they're kind of picking up that slack as consumer protections have been hurt in recent years.
David, much has been said about the every time the market tries to gain traction of late, something happens to derail it. And it's like direction is something people cannot get a handle on. The economy remains robust, consumer confidence in and out of multi-year highs. Save maybe the real estate industry, which is definitely slowing down a little bit. It's not evident in other, you know, areas where consumers are busy buying, like retail and what have you. So what do you make of what this market's telling us these wild days?
The biggest headwind is the fact that this trade war and tariff issue continues to linger. And when you combine that with kind of weakening global conditions, it has set up a headwind even in the face of a U.S. economy and U.S. corporate profits that are doing very well. So I think that until we get some clarity, even if it's an interim fix on the issue with China and this trade war, it's very unlikely that the market can get outside of a range bound. But right now, Neil, I don't think you're seeing markets in a downward trajectory. I think you're seeing a refocus of what the leadership is. You've seen really strong performance from a lot of the value names, large cap, strong balance sheet, a lot of dividend growers, and you've seen continued weakness in those very overpriced technology names. So you're just kind of seeing that long-awaited transition, and I think it's very healthy in the long run.
Yeah, it wasn't that long ago, Meredith, and you were talking about, you know, leadership does change even in a bull market, ongoing bull market. It's a healthy sign. We've certainly seen a lot of money come out of technology. Apple today on the verge of being a bear market territory, about 1% or so away from what would be a 20% drop from its highs reached just in early October. What do you make of that, and whether people are finally saying, or investors are generally saying, enough with technology?
I mean, I think that's a very valid point. I think that there's been a lot of skepticism about this rally really the whole time. And when you have that kind of lack of enthusiasm, it can be hard to stay in, right? Investors are kind of saying, you know, where should I take profits? And I think that especially after so many years, after these tech giants just keep getting bigger and bigger, people really want to look for an excuse to get out. And there are, you know, capital gains benefit new programs now that have been coming out that help kind of give you a different thing to do and find a new way to kind of get out of the stock market. And even with, you know, savings accounts now offering up to 2%, why would you stay in a stock that's, you know, by many traditional metrics, so overvalued? So I think people are really weighing that and trying to make a rational decision based on that.
Mary, final word. David, thank you, as always, guys.